Welcome to the Delmarva Almanac. Each week we connect you to the best of Delmarva. Now here's naturalist Dave Wilson and a couple of friends to tell us about the Diamondback Terrapin.
My guest today is Scott Smith with Jen Rafter from the Maryland Coastal Bays Program. Scott is a wildlife ecologist for DNR's Natural Heritage Program, where he has worked with birds, reptiles, and amphibians for 26 years. Jen Rafter is the technical coordinator for the Maryland Coastal Bays Program. She oversees their terrapin monitoring program, as well as tracking the program's environmental progress and coordinating climate adaptation and resilience activities. You two, welcome.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
Scott, I want to start with you. Can you discuss the biology of terrapins, sort of what they eat, where they live, where they go in the winter?
The diamondback terrapin is our only species that lives in brackish water, in salt ponds, salt marshes, near the beach. Terrapins are adapted to excrete the excess salt in their system, which would be lethal to a lot of other turtle species. They have really three main habitat criteria. They need sandy beach areas for nesting. They need marsh habitat for the juveniles and for feeding. And they need open water areas, deeper open water for females and near shore areas for males and the juveniles.
Can you talk a little bit about what terrapins eat?
Sure. Terrapins are kind of a diet specialist. They're what we call a molluscivore. That means they feed on mollusks or shellfish. And so snails and clams and mussels are a big part of their diet. They'll also opportunistically feed on a lot of other things, such as different types of crabs. There's even some suggestion that they will intake eelgrass seeds while they're feeding on other things. And they're responsible for helping spread eelgrass around in the marsh area.
Terrapins have quite a history in Maryland. Can you talk about that, plus what precipitated the ban on harvesting?
Sure. Native Americans ate terrapins. They certainly used them in some of the rituals. And then when the North America was colonized by Europeans, Europeans also quickly adapted to eating them like the Native Americans. But also there became a commercial harvest of them. Around the turn of last century, the late 1800s, early 1900s, terrapins were a gourmet treat in the finest restaurants worldwide. And because of over-harvesting, their numbers went down. And so for quite a period of time, around the 1920s, the populations had pretty much plummeted.
How does DNR keep track of their populations in the state?
So we have a number of ways we keep track of terrapins. First off, we have a really great relationship with Dr. Willem Rosenberg from Ohio University, who's been studying terrapins in Maryland for 25 plus years, starting with a long-term population study in the Patuxent River, and now he's working at Poplar Island in Talbot County. Turtle populations are hard to track their trends unless you really track them over long periods of time because they are so long-lived. So there is huge value for us in looking at his data and him sharing his data with us. We also have been coordinating a statewide terrapin headcount survey where scientists and citizen scientists go out on the water in boats and count terrapins in the spring.
Yeah, I know one of the things that precipitated that was the concern about crab pots and they're getting caught and killed in crab pots. Maybe you want to talk a little bit about that.
Sure. So the crab pot that we use now was first developed in the Chesapeake Bay in Virginia, and then it was adopted in the 1940s here in Maryland. And right off the bat, watermen noticed that it was drowning and killing terrapins and other fish and other things. And so initially, its use was banned in the 1940s by the legislature. And then when it came back into use a couple of years later, it was only allowed to be used in deeper water habitats. So like right now in our regulations, DNR regulations, from a commercial standpoint, crab pots can't be used in water that's less than 4 feet deep. And so the idea there is to keep them out in deeper water where you're not going to impact the larger number of terrapins. However, in the 1970s, regulations were passed that allowed their use by recreational crabbers, i.e. shoreline landowners, in those same tributaries where we know we have large terrapin populations. And thus, over the years, there's been many records and reports of crab pots being filled with dead terrapins. And so in 1999, after research done again by Dr. Rosenberg, we adapted regulations to require terrapin excluder devices, or what we call BRDs, bycatch reduction devices, from recreational crab pots. and those have been a help. But our problem right now is we're not seeing as much use by the public as we'd like.
Jen, can you tell me a little bit about the Maryland Coastal Bays program work with terrapins?
Sure. Since 2011, as part of the Maryland Terrapin Working Group that Scott heads, the Maryland Coastal Bays program has helped to organize volunteers for citizen science terrapin surveys. We do these surveys in the spring when the terrapins emerge, usually the week after Memorial Day. This spring, 27 volunteers sighted over 400 terrapins, and the surveys take place by motorboat or kayak, canoe, even stand-up paddle boards. And also, for the past 2 years, people have done land surveys using spotting scopes.
Is there an easy way for folks to get involved in that? Is there a website or a phone number?
Sure. You can give me an email at jrafter@mdcoastalbays.org or call 410-213-2297, extension 105. And you can also go to mdcoastalbays.org, and there is a link on our homepage for the Terrapin Project.
How about turtle excluder devices? Is there a way to get those on crab pots if people are interested?
That's a great question. Maryland Coastal Bays Program actually has free bycatch reduction devices or terrapin excluder devices through a grant from the Community Foundation of the Eastern Shore. And if you're interested in getting some of those, give Sandy an email at sandis@mdcoastalbays.org, and we would be happy to help you out with those as long as supplies last.
We've been talking to Scott Smith with the Maryland Department of Natural Resources and Jen Rafter at the Maryland Coastal Bays Program about terrapins today. For more information on terrapins and their habitats and what you can do to help terrapins, go to delmarvaalmanac.com/nature.
Thanks, Dave. Well, that's all for this edition of the Delmarva Almanac. Be sure to follow us on Facebook or Twitter, and next week join us to learn more about our local culture and get connected to our natural wonders. We'd like to thank our community partners, the Friends of Delmarva Public Radio, and our underwriters for their help in bringing this program to you, our audience. If you'd like to become an underwriter for this program, visit delmarvaalmanac.com/support. Our theme music was provided by Brightside Studio. This show has been a Moonshell production. Thanks for listening. Until we meet again, may the rhythms and tides of Delmarva bring you good fortune.